Me now?
There we go. Yay, look at all the people in my office. Where's your dog? Last time we did this, your dog barked through the whole thing.
It wasn't mine. It was my mom's.
Oh yeah. Okay. There you go. Mm-hmm. Throw your mom under the bus. You guys ready? Yeah. Want to rock? Hey, everybody. It's me, Tom Dalton, for the PBS TV show Under the Radar Michigan. And I'm here with three people who do not need an introduction. However, I'm going to do it anyway. I'm with Dave Lorenz from Pure Michigan. And it says in his contract, he gets 3 seconds for applause. Hold on.
Yeah, there we go. Okay.
John Gonzalez and Amy Sherman from MLive.com and Michigan's Best Series. And you guys did something for Black History Month that made me really hungry.
Well, this video was just, it was something else. It was, I don't want to use the word, life-changing, but it was a chance to go behind the scenes and get to meet some restaurant owners as we continue to celebrate Black History Month, not only in the month of February, but throughout the year, but to hear their stories, their struggles, their goals, their accomplishments. As I think everyone on this call knows, and anyone listening or watching knows, the pandemic and how it affected the restaurant industry is a story that we're just starting to scratch the surface. And then when you factor in, other issues about the culture and the time that we're living in, it's a story that you just can't wrap up in 2 minutes.
Well, what's the name of the place up in Thompsonville? Because I was so upset. I was just up there and I didn't realize that place was there. Amazing. All four of the places you featured.
Well, we're excited to tell you about all of the places, but you're right. We went to four different restaurants in Michigan. I love that we had two in Detroit, and we had one in Thompsonville, Gino's. Yeah. Up there, which I've never been to as well, but you will see it in the video. And then in Grand Rapids at a barbecue place. So all four different businesses from around the state of Michigan. And I know, Dave, you travel as much as we do. And well, I guess, Tom, you travel too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. we all travel. It's fun to discover new places.
Well, the neat thing about this is, you showed so many foods being prepared, and Tom's right, man, oh man, that made me super hungry for the food and made me really want to get in there. Those shots were great and the food looked spectacular. And like so many people, when I'm traveling, I'm usually going to fast food restaurants because I'm in a hurry, because so much of my travel is for work. But to even, I know, and even and when know. I'm traveling, I just take the easy way out and I do the drive-through and all that. But here's the thing, we can get into restaurants again. So we might as well take the time to do it, especially when you can go to these places that are spectacular. And Amy, I know you kind of, found East Eats in Detroit. Why don't you tell us about that? That looked great and those guys looked fantastic.
Yeah, that's probably my favorite restaurant I've been to over the last year. It's just absolutely incredible. John and I were doing our search for Michigan's Best Outdoor Dining, and that was one of the places that I had picked. And the cool thing about East Eats is that it was created in response to the pandemic. So it was not a restaurant that existed before. Three friends started it, Kwaku, Lloyd, and then their friend Nigel came together really with the sense of how can we create something that the community can enjoy, and then how do we do it on a shoestring budget essentially, and place it in a neighborhood in Detroit that doesn't have a lot of resources. So Kwaku owns a house that is located literally right next door to the East Eats empty lot that they, because he's a neighbor, in the neighborhood, he had the opportunity to purchase the lot. And then their whole concept was to create this igloo village in this abandoned lot in the Chalmers Jefferson neighborhood of Detroit. And then they partnered with a local catering company to use their kitchen as a commissary kitchen. So Lone Star Barbecue is the catering company. It's 1 mile straight up the road. They prepare all of their food there, and they really have a focus on healthy cuisine, something, again, that is kind of lacking in that neighborhood. They also focused on a very low price point so that residents could actually come and enjoy this experience. Again, it all came from a sense of community. Lloyd is, he has a PhD in human development from the University of Pennsylvania. And he, this is what he does, is how do we get African-Americans involved in the community? How do we raise them up? And so he's doing it this time with his partners and through food. And it's just absolutely spectacular and completely unique. I have not come across this type of concept anywhere else. And I love it. And they're going to continue to do it. They even made sure to purchase these special igloos that have covers on them, so they can continue to use them in the summertime. So this is going to be a kind of a permanent neighborhood spot for that part of Detroit.
Well, and I really do hope that we see more of this type of innovation. You know, when COVID first hit, we talked right here about the fact that a lot of these innovations that were happening, we kind of hope that maybe this would spur on, new ways to do things after COVID. And here's a great example. You know, what a great, cool restaurant. And that food, again, man, oh man, it looks spectacular.
In a way, it's kind of giving restaurants another dimension, another way to market and sell and to accommodate people. And let's face it, food is so much a part of travel. For a lot of people, it's not the secondary. It's the first thing they think about when they travel. And in Michigan, we have so many incredible restaurants and so many new ones opening, even in the midst of COVID, this is a great place to meander.
Yeah. Now, where were the other two? There was another one in Detroit and another one in Grand Rapids.
In Grand Rapids, we went to Daddy Pete's Barbecue, husband and wife team. And I think in our travels, Amy and I for M Live and Tom, of course, and Dave, all of us travel. We run into these husband and wife teams, right? And to run a business with your spouse is just mind-blowing. How do you do that, right? At the end of the day, I don't even know how you survive the day. Corey and Tara Davis, Daddy Pete's, have a great story. They met at New Hope Baptist Church in Grand Rapids. They were both doing youth ministry. Corey was a social worker, but his dad, Pete, did barbecue, kind of a family barbecue things. And Corey said, I need a stress relief here. I need to do something different just to get my mind off of work and everything. And he started barbecuing. And Tara's funny. She's like going, it was so bad when we first started. We did a Dave. We went to the fast food places because if he said he was getting barbecue out, we said, no way, count us out, right? Well, 10 years later, they have a thriving food truck that are tons of events. They opened up a brick and mortar on 28th and Eastern Avenue in Grand Rapids. They also just added a plant-based menu because the doctor says, hey, we got to be health conscious here. And they're doing barbecue. They're doing plant-based foods at a barbecue place in Grand Rapids. Well, yeah. So their story is something else. The brisket, I'll tell you what, I took some brisket home the other day and I put it in my car and my whole car smelled like brisket.
And that's okay. If you could bottle that, I would buy it.
They have their own sauces and their own rubs and everything. They're doing everything homemade. They're using fruit wood to do it. And I'll pass along that idea, Dave, so they can bottle up brisket.
What 10% of a good idea would come up to. This is great. That brisket looked the best. I mean, honestly, wow.
Yeah, those guys are great. We've known them now for a couple of years. Love them. The other place we went to is in Detroit. It's called Yum Village. It's been there for, I want to say about two years now. The owner, Godwin Ihentuki, is got African-American on his mom's side and African on his dad's side. He's making Afro-Caribbean cuisine. And some of those pictures, when you look at that video, that's holy cow, that stuff looks so delicious. And it is delicious. John and I got to try a ton of it. He's got a really, it's all about the community. He's located near Wayne State University in Detroit. It's kind of like I would describe it as a fast casual restaurant. There is sit down dining inside, but you can go in and you can kind of pick your own cuisine, almost like a Qdoba, where you can pick your protein and then what kind of rice you have. He makes five kinds of rice. Including jollof rice, and he's the only person in the world, he thinks, who's making hibiscus rice, which is crazy. The food is super fresh, really healthy, and definitely a reflection of his upbringing. He likes to say that he was Detroit raised, but African made, and that's what his food is like. It definitely has that wonderful spices and incredible flavorings of African cuisine, but he is in the middle of Detroit, and so he's using Michigan ingredients. And it's just a really, it's a really great story. It's a really fun place. He hosts things like drumming circles there and other community events. And so it's much more than a restaurant at Yum Village.
Wow, it's really cool. Well, Tom, I know you guys, you've been to so many restaurants and such. And, yeah. And there was a restaurant that you went to recently for one of your shows.
Was it Sweet Potato Sensations?
Yeah, that's the one. I mean,
I was just gonna bring that up because they have a very similar story. They're right across from Redford Theater in Detroit. And it's an African-American owned business. And it all started with, you know, trying to make ends meet and with selling cookies out of their garage at a garage sale. And now they have this incredible business where they have everything you can imagine sweet potato, from savory to sweet pies. They have sauces, and it's incredible. The whole family's involved. They've created just this whole different mood and atmosphere down in that part of the city. So yeah, it's called Sweet Potato Sensations. And if you like sweet potatoes, and it is a superfood, just so you know, but that's a great place to go.
You know, the fact is that, you know, we shouldn't just see, you know, trying to appreciate a culture like Black history as being a 1 month thing. If we're ever going to kind of break through this, you know, cultural divide between, you know, people, we need to try to explore each other's culture and get to know each other a little bit better. And I can't think of a better way to be enlightened. See how I did that? Enlightened. Then, you know, to go in and have, you know, meals together.
Yeah.
It's a great way to get to know each other.
You know, that's very well said. There's no better way to understand someone else's culture, their life, who they are, what they're about, than to sit down and break bread with them and get to know people. Once you get to know people, we're all the same. You know, not everybody's ugly like me, but we're all the same. So yeah, you get to know people, I think the world changes.
That's right. Everybody wants a better life for their kids and grandkids. Now, where do we find this MLive video, guys?
It'll be on the Michigan's Best Facebook page. You'll find it there. It should be up there right now. So just go check out Michigan's Best Facebook. We'd appreciate it. But before we wrap things up, though, if you don't mind, I just want to say one more thing. When you, Dave, you mentioned about celebrating Black History Month every single day. And I think every person we interviewed for this video would echo the same sentiment, right? But I also want to point out that there is diversity within those communities. And I think we forget that. Amy pointed out that the three young men that run East Eats, they're all from different backgrounds, right? And I think sometimes, wrongly, most of the times we say, well, in this community, they do that. In this community, they do this. No, take a look at this video and every single person featured comes from a different background, mm-hmm. a different history, right? They bring their life to the forefront through food, but they're all so different. Gino, we didn't spend a lot of time talking about him up in Thompsonville. You know, he grew up in Thompsonville. He calls himself a country boy, right? He grew up hunting, fishing, and wrestling there in Benzie Central High School and at Ferris State University. Then he goes to Detroit, and he says, well, what a culture shock it was to go to Detroit, right? And learn about, he says, the only thing I knew was what I grew up with here in Thompsonville, right? So he brings a different perspective, and the reactions he gets when you're up there visiting up at Crystal Mountain or wherever, and you go into his restaurant, and he goes, oh, you know, it's Gino. I thought you were Italian, you know? No, I'm not. So I think as we explore the different foods and the cultures throughout the year, people of color come from different backgrounds, and we should celebrate that as well.
Yeah, well said.
Absolutely true. Well said. Yep, absolutely. Well, and of course, I want people to get back into restaurants as soon as they feel comfortable to do so, and to support every restaurant that we have in the state, because, man, we need to do that right now. You know, support local restaurants and retailers and others, so they'll be there when better times are to be had. And those times are going to be coming very soon. So let's do our work to eat as much as we can.
Yeah. I was going
to
say,
I'm going to make a pledge to do that myself.
I've been telling you, Dave Lorenz, to not eat any fast food for 2021. Only eat at local restaurants. Can you do that? Can you commit to that?
Please.
I've been on the road with Dave. It's going to be tough.
No way. I like that. Yeah. I can tell but I am going to do my best.
I can tell I've been supporting local restaurants because I'm down to 3 pair of pants. I can only get into 3 pair of pants.
Oh, yeah. You're just growing so pants. Fast there,
Tom. You have pants yeah. on, Tom?
Well, not now. Let's not end it there.
I thought we would end it there at the end.
And end it there. Exactly. And I'm going to say one more thing. Tip generously. Yeah. Our restaurant workers need it so badly. So when you do go out, please tip generously.
Oh, even when I do carry out, I do like 25-30% always. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good idea. Okay, guys. Thanks a lot. And I'll see you at the restaurant.
I'm going to get my pants on.